around the South China Sea. So in the previous session, we had a big picture, sort of a view of what's happening in the region. In the following session, we're going to be focusing on the major powers and their interaction. So in this session, without ignoring these other issues, we'll have an opportunity to focus on dynamics amongst the claimants and involved actors in the South China Sea, and looking at some and the situation, the maritime delimitations and things like that. So without further ado, we'll go in the order that you see printed in the program. I'll ask each speaker to stay within the 12, I was going to say the 12 mile limit, the 12 minute limit, and I will trust you to do this, but I will verify. After 12 minutes, I will notify you that your time is up. So our first speaker is going to be Ms. Rukmani Gupta from IHS Jains.
Good afternoon. I'm Rukmani. I'm a senior analyst for military capabilities with IHS Jains. Before I begin my talk, I do want to highlight that I am here speaking in my personal capacity, and the views expressed within my talk are my own and not representative of my employer. So my talk today will look at essentially the reclamation and building activities underway within the Spratlys. I've chosen the Spratlys essentially because within the two and a half years, it is within the Spratly group that we find the largest number and the most extensive reclamation work and construction activity being undertaken. Now, this map shows the various claimants and the various features claimed by the various countries, and this map essentially highlights the proximity of the various features and serves to underline why construction on any one of these features or the enhancement of military infrastructure on any one of these features is a cause of concern for other claimants. Currently, there are three countries that are undertaking land reclamation work within the Spratlys, and this includes Taiwan, Vietnam, and China. So although China is not the only country or even the very first country to undertake reclamation or building work within the Spratlys, we would do well to remember that its work is in fact the most intensive and extensive. So China has very quickly created a very large number of features or has added significantly to artificial terrain on features that it already controls. The second thing to remember is that all of these countries are in fact building on features that they already control. So none of them is going out to occupy new features so as to, and this I believe serves a dual purpose. One, not only does it ensure the continuity of their claim over a particular feature, but also obviously serves to mitigate the critique that they are being expansionist, whatever the reality on the ground may be. So while under, my contention is that although under UNCLOS, artificial installations as represented by reclaimed terrain or the new construction on these features does not enjoy the same status as natural islands, however, this reclamation work effectively permits countries to redefine access, rules of access, and effectively change the rules of play on the ground, or effectively change the status quo on the sea, irrespective of UNCLOS, irrespective of international law, irrespective, in fact, of historical claims. So to begin with, I'll talk about Taiwan and its efforts on Ituaba, Taiping Island. So as you all know, Taiwan essentially controls one major landmass within the Spratlys, which is Ituaba. The surface work on the construction of a 1,200 meter runway, or airstrip actually, on the island was completed between 2005 and 2006. Taiwan has most recently expanded the support installations associated with this airstrip, and land reclamation has been undertaken since April last year to significantly expand the harbor facilities on Taiping Tao. So we can see in this imagery these two images taken from between June and October 2015, where you can see how the harbor infrastructure under construction. I think I'm going to use the pointer here. So you can see a harbor infrastructure under construction and slipways that are nearly complete. There is also the creation of new terrain within the harbor area. What is interesting to note is that Taiwan, unlike China, is utilizing excavation barges rather than suction dredgers to complete its reclamation work on Taiping Tao. And this may explain why the reclamation work undertaken by Taiwan or perhaps even other countries has been so much slower than China. So China is just employing different equipment to essentially complete the same work. This imagery is a composite image of the island in its whole, and we can see that Taiwan is making steady progress towards the completion of the harbor. We can also see that there is new terrain being cleared on the northwestern edge of the island, which suggests that there may be further construction underway here in the future. There are also new airfield installations close to the airstrip that you can see on the top of that image there. So we can see that Taiwan is extending its facilities or infrastructure on Taiping Tao. And in the rest of the presentation, you will have the opportunity to compare this with what efforts have been undertaken by Vietnam and by China. So as far as Vietnam is concerned, four features show signs of land reclamation activity by Vietnam within the Spratlys, and these include Central London Reef, Southwest Cay, West London Reef, and Sand Cay. Of these four, there is continuing land reclamation activity on at least two, and that is on West London Reef and on Sand Cay. In this image, you can see the original facility here. And you can see that there has been an extensive addition to the landmass, which in fact encompasses the original facility. There is also significant expansion of the harbor. So whereas there were only very small structures present, what has now become the harbor shows significant reclamation work. On Sand Cay also, we can see that between 2012 and 2014, significant new terrain has been added. And on this newly constructed terrain, there is evidence of the construction of defensive structures such as bunkers and also gun emplacements. So there is a focus in the media on China and its militarization, which is of course justified, but these developments serve to underline the fact that China is not the only country that is engaged in this. However, the scale, as we will see in subsequent slides, is quite different. And this brings us to Chinese efforts in the Spratlys. So seven of the 10 features that China controls in the Spratlys show evidence of land reclamation and building activities. Within these, Quarterton Reef, Gavin Reefs, Hughes Reef, Johnson South Reef, and to some extent Mischief Reef are receiving limited new buildings. Well, in the case of Mischief Reef, this is under debate because we're yet to see the completion of what China does here. But Fiery Cross Reef and Subi Reef represent the largest expansion projects that China has undertaken in the Spratlys. Here, on both of these islands, we see the construction, in the case of Fiery Cross Reef, the completion of a fairly large airstrip. Again, I would like to underline the fact that China is the fifth claimant to create an airstrip in the Spratlys, not the first. So it is playing catch up, but it seems that it has not only caught up with other claimants, but in fact surpassed them as far as creation of infrastructure is concerned on these islands. So we see here in Gavin Reef, there is the original structure from the image in March 2014, and only a few months later, about 5 months later, by August 2014, we see that there is a huge artificial island or artificial terrain that has been created. In these images, you can see that the original structure is still not connected to the new artificial terrain. But again, in a matter of a few months, we see that the original structure has in fact been encompassed within larger terrain. Similarly, also on Hughes Reef, there is the original structure that can be seen on the left of the image, and this has been encompassed within fairly large artificial terrain created by China. An interesting feature of Chinese construction activity in the South China Sea has included the creation of temporary ro-ro piers. So roll-on, roll-off piers have been created that permit the disembarkation of construction equipment and material. And in this image, if you can see, there is a ramp attached to this particular vessel, which permits the disembarkation of material on the ro-ro pier. Eventually, as construction proceeds, there is a wall that is constructed so that the ro-ro pier eventually just washes away back into the sea. So it is seldom that China has maintained or retained these ro-ro piers, and these are a feature of its construction activities. Again, on Johnson South 3, if you can see that there is an original structure that has been encompassed by a fairly large artificial terrain. Again, there is the feature of the ro-ro pier and the use of ramps on vessels to disembark construction equipment. Mischief Reef represents one of the more recent efforts by China to reclaim land within the Spratly Islands. Here you can see that there is sediment deposition within the reef, and if you compare the status of the island now, or the status of the feature now, you can see that there has been extensive reclamation work that China has undertaken here. And it has been posited by some islands that Mischief Reef may well present in the future the third airstrip within the Spratlys for China after Fiery Cross and Subi Reef, which brings us to Fiery Cross Reef. Here again, you can see the original structure, which is fairly small on the left-hand side of this image. And you can see that there are dredgers depositing sediment along the north, along the top of this image. These two images give a fairly comprehensive picture of just how fast China can move, or how quickly China has been able to create artificial terrain. So within the matter of a few weeks, the top image is from February 2015, the lower image is from March 2015, and we see that there is already runway installation underway. There is also a clear deepening of the harbor, which is evident from these images. So on the top, you can see the seafloor, but on the bottom image, you can see that that coloration is fairly deep, so that indicates that there is a deepening of the harbor. Again, this close-up of the image from March shows just how China goes about installing a runway on Fiery Cross. And when we come to this image from September 2015, we see that runway markings have been completed. China is in the latter phases of operationalizing this airstrip, even as construction is continuing on auxiliary buildings or other concrete structures in Fiery Cross. This brings us to Subi Reef. This photograph essentially shows the original structure, which was fairly small. As with most original structures, the small structure was attached to a helipad or a sort of basic pier. But this, again, has been expanded extensively within the course of, say, 4 to 5 weeks. And if we look at imagery from September, we see that there is already gradation work being undertaken, which is the step prior to runway installation, and that is ongoing at Subi Reef. Now, Chinese construction in the Spratlys seems to follow a particular blueprint, and there can be facility comparison when you look at the construction activity on various islands. So these two images from Gavin Reef and Hughes Reef show that the layout and the dimensions of the primary structure is fairly similar. There is also those hexagonal points you can see on the four corners of the images. And if we compare this with other installations, we know that these are going to be defensive structures that are possibly going to be radars or sensors of some sort. Another interesting development is the creation of, or what has been seen as, a large concrete ramp on many facilities within the Spratlys. So at first glance, it seems like a sort of mysterious ramp that emerges from the land and goes up to the second or third floor of these concrete buildings. And it has been suggested that these ramps will facilitate the movement and concealment of mobile artillery pieces in the Spratlys by China in the future. Another important development is, and I think this is related to construction activity underway, is the expansion of non-naval fleets, not just by China, but also other claimants. Here we see that there are two 10,000-ton cutters for the Chinese Coast Guard that have been launched. If we look at China's utilization, and in fact the utilization of white hulls by all countries or all claimants in the region, these again serve a dual purpose. So not only do they delineate claim lines, but also serve as controlling or signaling resolve while preventing escalation. So whereas you could have a military confrontation between gray hulls, the utilization of white hulls means that conflict escalation is limited or curtailed to a certain degree. There is a huge capacity gap between the Chinese maritime agencies and Coast Guard and other Coast Guards in the region. So the Chinese Coast Guard has access to over 200 vessels and at least between a tonnage of 800 to 4,000 tons. And at least half of these, which is at least 100 of these, have a tonnage of greater than 1,000 tons. So when we compare this to Coast Guard capabilities for Taiwan, Taiwan has no more than 10 Coast Guard vessels that have a tonnage of greater than 1,000 tons. Vietnam has possibly maybe 5 hulls that have a tonnage of greater than 1,000 tons. And related to this is civil-military integration for the Chinese military and Chinese military thinking. So as China brings in gray hulls to support its Coast Guard or its white hull operations within the Spratlys, there is not only the gap between capabilities as far as naval capabilities are concerned, but also a gap in white hull capabilities that China represents. So how is it that other claimants will be able to defend themselves? I'm going to skip over the likely military assets that the various countries may deploy to this region, but I would like to highlight the fact that China's J-11Bs that belong to the South Sea Fleet already function from the airstrip at Woody Island. So the J-11B is among the most modern aircraft in China's inventory. It is a fourth generation fighter that has, you know, it can target multiple target capabilities. So if China does in fact utilize these for patrols over the Spratlys, this could well change the security dynamic within the southern reaches of the South China Sea. In conclusion, I just want to say that, to my mind, land reclamation and building activities are paving the way for rapid militarization of reclaimed features. And faced with the might of the PLA Navy, as well as China's white hulls, other claimants are rapidly also investing in naval modernization. And what these two narratives does is it entrenches, according to me, nationalist positions over respective claims. So what you have is the creation of a positive feedback loop in which these three dynamics are constantly reinforced and will lead to greater instability in the region. And I would just like to end by saying that status quo, as defined by effectively curtailing activity that was hitherto undertaken by various claimants, is already underway within the South China Sea. So we don't have to wait for a clear militarization of these reclaimed features, but if we see the stopping of resupply vessels to Second Thomas Shoal, or even the necessity of freedom of navigation patrols, all of this indicates that the status quo is already changing. So thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Dr. Mathieu Duchatel from the European Council on Foreign Relations.
Thank you, Chair, and thanks to the organizers for inviting me. As a disclaimer, I should say that although the European Council on Foreign Relations has council in its name, it's not an institution of the European Union. It's an independent think tank with offices in different European capitals. My starting point is a very simple question. To what extent do military security concerns explain China's policy in the South China Sea? And in particular, does it make sense to isolate nuclear security as a driver for China's recent policy moves in the past, let's say, 6 years after the USNS impeccable incident? In short, the answer is yes, and I argue in the paper that the vulnerability of the PLA Navy's ballistic missile submarines is an important determinant of China's South China Sea policy. For analysts and for policymakers, it matters for two reasons. First, I think because we tend to overlook military security concerns and nuclear deterrence when analyzing China's policies. And a look at the recently published literature, including on land reclamation activities, shows that other factors are being emphasized to explain China's policies. We see geopolitics, US-China rivalry, we see domestic politics, nationalism, regime legitimacy, also economic interest with the rise of China as a major maritime economy, or even reactive assertiveness, which is not purely a military explanation. So there's a flurry of factors that is given to explain Chinese policies, and as a result, there's also a lack of analytical clarity. And second, even when military security is mentioned, I think there's a lack of compelling evidence because, for one thing, there is no authoritative statement by the PLA regarding the military value of the South China Sea. So in the time I have, I will try to review the evidence available from open source material to argue that indeed the South China Sea has important, if not decisive, value for the PLA Navy's deterrence strategy. I think that we have four main elements. The first is that surveillance with an anti-submarine warfare component is a primary security concern for China, and one that has been raised to the level of top priority after the 2009 USNS impeccable incident, and now brought to the core of China's military diplomacy towards the US as part of the three great obstacles to establishing normal military-to-military ties. And this is a Chinese obsession, and to be fair, I think that the threat perception in China is based on facts. And there are two intertwined trends with regards to military surveillance in the South China Sea. One of them is that states with a claim, plus the US, are rapidly acquiring and deploying surveillance equipment, and I have detailed that in the paper. And the second factor is that there is a trend towards regional integration of intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance capabilities within the US alliance system, and in a way that can be described as a hub and spokes fashion. The second element, and this is also just a fact, is that China doesn't have a viable nuclear deterrence capability under sea. And building one has been a national priority of China since the late 1950s, and is even a key reason for the Sino-Soviet split at the end of the 1950s. Today, China has four nuclear ballistic missile submarines, but they also have three major weaknesses. One is that they don't have a reliable submarine-launched ballistic missile. Second is that they are too noisy, and Russia will probably never or at least not now, there are no signs that Russia will transfer the noise reduction propulsion capacities that China needs. And finally, when you compare the Chinese nuclear submarines with the Soviet nuclear submarines during the Cold War, a big difference is just the number of submarines. China has only four. The Soviet Union at the height of the Cold War had 70 ballistic missile submarines, and they were still being tracked by the US Navy. So in a word, China is in a state of absolute vulnerability. And I think this is a key point. It's a safer bet for China to try to protect submarines within the first island chain than to try to cross the first island chain undetected, because this is the likelihood of being detected is extremely high. Third element, there are signs that China is precisely considering this. Operating nuclear submarines and initiating nuclear patrols in the South China Sea. And this has a name, it's called a bastion strategy. This was part of the Soviet Navy's nuclear posture during the Cold War. And the Soviet experience in the seas of Okhotsk and Barents shows that it is extremely challenging because it means achieving air and sea superiority, strong anti-submarine warfare capabilities, etc. So we are really not there yet. And as I said earlier, the PLA does not communicate on this threat perception and nuclear posture, But the term bastion exists in China's specialized literature. And also, there has been a transfer of knowledge from Russia, including on the use of aircraft carriers as air defense patrol to protect submarines. The fourth element has been described by the speaker before me, is the militarization of the South China Sea by China, and especially the kind of military activities that China is conducting in the South China Sea, which suggests that the end game for the PLA is to establish an ADIZ de facto without the need to declare one, and precisely to complicate and ultimately to interdict surveillance operations. This would deserve listing the facts and the details, and in a way, everything that China does as part of the anti-access or area denial strategy applies to the South China Sea. But to be more specific, I think it's important to look at the construction of artificial islands in the Spratly. Is this part of a counter-surveillance strategy? My answer is yes. Because first, as we saw on the pictures, there is radar equipment and there will be more in the future, very likely. And this will help China to gain better maritime awareness. And another sign is the presence of helipads, which can support anti-submarine warfare operations. And of course, as it has been pointed out by many experts, the artificial islands are extremely vulnerable. But I think that deterrence is also a game that is played in peacetime. So supporting anti-surveillance operation is clearly part of the intention of these constructions. So let me conclude with 3 points. Well, to China, I think that it is very unhelpful to deny that there is an ongoing militarization of the South China Sea. And for the sake of transparency and also to facilitate a diplomatic solution or diplomatic dialogue, I think that China should recognize that there is a perceived military vulnerability and that it is at the very core of China's approach in the South China Sea. To the US and to the other claimants in the South China Sea, I think it's worth to keep in mind that increased surveillance and freedom of navigation operations are perceived as a part of a game that is aimed at gaining an absolute strategic superiority over China and to deny China a credible nuclear deterrence capability. And in practice, it means that China's nuclear vulnerability is a complicating factor to any political settlement, and that the nuclear dimension of the problem in the South China Sea has political implications. And one of them is that any solution in the South China Sea may also require an arms control component between the US and China. And finally, to the international community, I think that there is, beyond the South China Sea, something larger at stake, and this is the legal dimension and the lack of clear legal status of military activities at sea. Clearly, there is a contest between the US on the one hand, China on the other hand, over the definition of what constitutes lawful military activities in EEZs. And on the one hand, China is leading a revisionist camp, but the problem of China is that it has never defined what is the EEZ in the South China Sea. And on the other hand, the US has a legitimacy deficit because it has not ratified UNCLOS. So I think, and I would like to conclude on that point, that it is in the interest of all maritime states to reach in the future a common understanding of what constitutes legal military activities in EEZs. And in that sense, the South China Sea is part of something larger. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, and you kept within your time limit. Admirable. Now next we have Professor Herman Joseph Kraft, Associate Dean for Administration at the College of Social Sciences and Philosophy in the Philippines. You have a slideshow?
Oh, there you go. Right. Good afternoon, everyone. And I'd like to start with a note of thanks to the organizers for inviting me to this conference. When I was actually given the task of talking about the overall situation in the South China Sea, at some facetious moment, I was actually wondering whether I should actually look at fish stocks and the environment as part of the presentation. Honestly speaking, I think I should have, just to actually differentiate some of the things I'm going to say from this morning's session. The thing is that I think one of the things about the speakers this morning is the extent to which certain topics were actually discussed in very discrete ways. You know, the issue about China and the United States, you know, whether there are actually legal gray areas that need to be actually explored in that, and then of course ASEAN and so on. I think one of the things that has to be taken into consideration is how this picture actually comes together, and that's one of the things that I would I'd actually like to talk about. South China Seas have always been, or the South China Sea has always been discussed as a hotspot as far as security in the Asia-Pacific region is concerned. I think I'm old enough to actually remember when CSCAP first started listing these kinds of hotspots and talked about the idea of South China Sea as one of them. But at that time, back in the 1990s, no, I think the idea of the South China Sea as a hotspot was really more of was seen in terms of its potential for conflict, you know, as something that's hypothetical, so to speak. When we talk about the South China Sea now and the issues related to it, I think one of the things that we're now seeing is that the concerns have more to do with the fact or the idea that the issues and the potential for conflict is now less hypothetical than it was before. That is to say, there's actually much more of a concern about what might actually happen. No. Hence, the language that's usually presented, no, has to do with the question of managing the dispute. My presentation has to do with the idea that perhaps our concern should be which dispute we're actually concerned about when we talk about the South China Sea. Please forgive me if I start with the Philippines. You know, there's something self-centered about it, you know, being from the Philippines. But if you look at it, many of the to a large extent, the main concerns that actually face the region right now over the South China Sea can be traced precisely to some of the things that have to do that involve the Philippines and China. In particular, you're talking about Scarborough Shoal, for instance, now in 2012. And if you look at that, I think the question about the Philippines claiming Scarborough Shoal, you know, is something that's actually quite interesting. The 1900 Washington Treaty should have actually settled that in the sense of correcting whatever things were actually lacking from the 1898 Treaty of Paris, you know, and a number of developments and activities undertaken by the Philippines, you know, since then, of course, asserts, you know, and or shows the extent to which the Philippines had always claimed, you know, and asserted its control or administrative control over Scarborough Shoal. Nonetheless, you have the problems with what happened in 2012, face-off and all that, which has led us to where we are now, and that has to do with the question of the Philippine submission to the Permanent Court of Arbitration. No? The non-participation of China, of course, is well known, no? And the decision of the PCA regarding jurisdiction over the case has been recently actually presented. This is the first part of the story that I will try to unfold, no, over my presentation. The second point that I'd actually be talking about is, of course, China's assertion of its sovereignty over the area covered by the 9-9, no, which is seen in terms of its increased presence in the area, and of course the reclamation projects that was so comprehensively discussed, no, by some other presenters in this panel. Third, and I think this is something that has to be emphasized, is of course the role of ASEAN in the whole thing, because we've always been talking about the importance of, and I think my friend Nam was actually talking about the importance of the docs, the code of conduct, no? But of course, we have to contend with issues that have to do with ASEAN itself. the divisions within ASEAN over the issue. And this does not, it's not only within ASEAN, but among the claimants themselves, no? Within, among the ASEAN member countries. No? And of course, the question of the extent to which we can see or make an assessment of the waning of ASEAN centrality. No? In as much as ASEAN's role in all of this has to do with, of course, playing the role of a multilateral platform where issues can actually be discussed, no, then this becomes, no, a problem that has to actually be taken into consideration. And then, of course, the U.S. rebalancing strategy, no, what it actually means. No? The U.S. more, the greater active involvement of the United States in the Asia-Pacific. No, more particularly, it's more active involvement in the South China Sea with its freedom of navigation patrols. And finally, I'll end my presentation with a discussion on what has been discussed in terms, or what is currently being discussed in terms of the potential for escalation into conflict of things that are actually going on in the South China Sea. Now, the events with regards to the Philippine case, of course, well known to everybody in this room. No, Philippine case submitted was submitted to the Permanent Court of Arbitration in the wake of the Scarborough Shoal case. And then, of course, China's position paper, no, came out in December of 2014. No, and the decision of the PCA confirming its jurisdiction over the case, no, which came out last October. Okay, this basically means that the Court of Arbitration will now be looking into the merits, no, of the case itself. Okay, and the extent to which, of course, those merits, no, illustrate, no, where the decision could actually be made. There is, of course, in the case of the Philippines, no, some sort of hope that a decision could actually be reached before or around middle of next year. This has to do more with domestic politics than anything else. No, the Philippines will be holding its elections in May of 2016, and the next administration will actually be taking over around July. So there is some concern over whether or not the decision will actually come out before the next administration takes over. Okay. Now, the thing is, did that decision change anything? And I think this goes back to the question as far as the Philippines is actually concerned. No, does it restore the status quo ante? As has been mentioned by an earlier presenter, no, things have changed, no, and the changes make it quite difficult, no, for any notion of us actually turning back to, no, the situation prior to Scarborough Shoal. Will it lead to greater participation of China in the arbitration process? Not likely, no, and less likely is, of course, the acceptance of the results of the process. Will it lead to a normalization of relations between the Philippines and China? This is, in fact, quite an interesting question because, to a certain extent, it's partly at the heart of the extent to which we talk about tensions now. No? Resolving tensions between the Philippines and China might actually go quite a ways, no? to reducing concerns about the potential for conflict in the South China Sea. I have my misgivings about that, which I'll be explaining later on. No? But in any case, there is hope that there will be a reduction in harassment, threats of harassment, no? In Philippine activities, no? In the South China Sea. Toning down of rhetoric, no? In the Chinese media about threats of retaliation against the Philippines. No? Again, some of the things that are actually hoped for, which we're not too sure about at this point in time. There has been, and I think this has to be emphasized, no? Number one, there's been less harassment as far as resupply activities, no, of Ayungin Shoal is actually concerned, no, which sends some sort of signal. And then, of course, the hope that decision of the Court of Arbitration will actually lead to stronger support for the Philippines within ASEAN. There has been some ASEAN statement, no, supporting the resolution of the issue. No, through international law mechanisms, but of course, no, that's a far way from supporting the Philippines as far as the issue is actually concerned. No, will it accelerate the process of establishing a code of conduct in the South China Sea? Well, I think Nam was actually talking about that earlier on, and that's not that seems to be something that's very difficult to actually project at this point in time. If you'll notice, there are actually more questions than explanations, no? About what the impact of that decision is actually concerned. And that's probably fair, because we're talking about a decision that just came out around a month ago. But it also illustrates how fluid the situation is, no? As far as, you know, finding some sort of way of dealing with the issues in the South China Sea. This brings us to the case of China. I'll just bring up 2 points, no? And this has to do with the continued non-participation in the arbitration case. Obviously, this strengthens China's position about how its non-participation, of course, means that it doesn't have, or it's seen as not having any obligation to actually abide by any decision, no? And the continued assertion of its sovereignty over the area covered by the 9-9 line. And you can see this in terms of the increased presence in the area, no? Those are pictures that show Vietnamese, Malaysian, and of course, Philippine ships. The picture to the left lower quadrant is of course a shot of a Chinese Coast Guard vessel through one of the portholes in the Sierra Madre in Ayungin Shoal. And of course, the reclamation projects, no? I only have two pictures here, no? One is of course that of Subi Reef, no? And the other one is of Fiery Cross Reef, which shows how much change has actually taken place in those areas, no, within the last year or so, okay? Which just illustrates just how massive the activities were, okay? But on the other hand, no, and this is something that's less discussed, no, is of course some signals that might have been sent by China towards the Philippines, no? The fact that President Xi Jinping actually attended the APEC summit in Manila might have actually been some sort of signal. The question, of course, is did the Philippines actually read those signals right, no? And the picture below is, of course, that infamous march through the red carpet, no, where Xi Jinping was allowed to actually walk alone. But the other thing, of course, is the recent ASEAN meeting, where again the Philippines, you know, brought out the issue. No, so I think these are things that need to actually be taken into consideration. ASEAN, no, has it become polarized over the issue? And I think that's one of the things that has to be taken into consideration. Being polarized means that ASEAN, no, is less effective, no, in trying to drive those kinds of arrangements that would actually allow mechanisms, no, for some sort of resolution over the case, no, the main issues right now, no. And so, is ASEAN still effective as a driver of regional security? Something that has to be taken into consideration. U.S. involvement in the South China Sea, the strengthening of ties with the Philippines and other allies, completion of negotiations, no, on the U.S. rotational deployment, no. And the Supreme Court decision in the Philippines on whether or not the expanded defense cooperation agreement will actually be found constitutional, no, is still an ongoing consideration. The provision of more explicit guarantees, no, has been discussed earlier on, but it's still there. And challenging China in the South China Sea with those freedom of navigation patrols, no. So let me conclude with this slide, no. I guess the point that has to be made is that the principal concern at the start of the year and at the start of the issue itself was the possibility of unintended events escalating into conflict. No, but these were mostly things that actually involved China and other claimant countries in the South China Sea. This was emphasized by the earlier panel. No, but increasingly now, and I think this is the picture that has to be that we have to be careful about. No. Is the extent to which the situation is actually being overtaken by the great power dynamic between China and the United States. Meaning to say, you know, to what extent can the other countries in the region actually play, or to what extent do the issues concerning the other countries in the region take a second become subsumed, you know, within the increasing dynamic dynamic of the relationship between China and the United States. Like I said, more questions than answers, no, but let me end there, and I welcome any question that you might actually have. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Dr. Le Quynh, who's the Director General of Maritime Affairs, the Vietnam Ministry of Foreign Affairs.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. I have very simple equipment to control my time. So Mr. Chairman, you don't need to remind me all the time.
Okay, I will do.
But anyway, I am the last speaker, so I have more time to go. So, as you know that in the South China Sea, I have only very simple map. But this map contains all information about the maritime delimitation and the soil development in the South China Sea. And in the South China Sea, there are existing many overlapping areas. Some of them have been delimited, but some of them are still in dispute. Some of them are in the process of negotiation, and some of them have been agreed to be the areas for joint development. So let's go from the north to the south. In the northern part of the South China Sea, we have the Gulf of Tonkin, bordered by China and Vietnam. And there was three stages of negotiation and consultation between Vietnam and China. The first stage in 1974, the second stage in 1977, and in 1978. The last stage in the from 1992 to 2000. In the first two stages, there was no result because the relation between the two countries that time was not so good. The last stage from 1992 to 2000, and on 25th December 2000, we concluded agreement on the delimitation of territoriality, EZ, and continental strength between the two countries in the Gulf of Tonkin. And that time, my boss, His Excellency Mr. Lê Công Phung, he was the head of the Vietnamese government delegation in negotiation with China. And his colleague is Mr. Vương Nghi, now is a minister of foreign affairs with China. So as a result, Vietnam gained about 53% of the Gulf, and China gained about 47% of the Gulf. You may ask me, why Vietnam is a small country compared with China, gained bigger portion of the Gulf in the Gulf? We are not smarter than Chinese colleagues, but we have a coastal island here, which were given full effect in the limitation. We have a small island, Bạch V, is the middle of the Gulf, and this island was given 25% of effect. And we have one island here, Quynh Island, was given 50% of effect. In the same day, we signed another agreement. It's agreement on the fishery cooperation in the Gulf of Tonkin. It means that we still have about 30% of the area of the Gulf for the cooperation between Vietnam and China. So the fishing vessel of China and fishing vessel of Vietnam can go to fish there in this area. In 2005, we signed another agreement on the joint development of a small area here for the oil and gas exploitation there. The second area, at the mouth of the Gulf of Tonkin here, we still have overlapping area between Vietnam and China. Vietnam claimed in this area based on the equidistance between the baseline of Vietnam in 1982 and baseline of China in 1996. But China never say about the claim in this area. But if we take the maximum claim of China based on the equidistant line between the two coasts of Vietnam and China, then one overlapping areas is about 1,100 square kilometers. And up to now, we have 7 rounds of consultation and meeting between the two countries, but no result have been reached. China wants to have only joint development, but Vietnam wants to have joint development and the limitation as well. So next area, in the southern part of Vietnam, we have the joint submission area for the extended continental chain between Vietnam and Malaysia, and this was submitted to the Commission for the Outer Limit of the Continental Chain of the United Nations in 2009. And the area is of about 42,000 square kilometers. And south of this area, we have one overlapping areas between Brunei and Malaysia. After 39 rounds of negotiation and consultation in 2009, the two countries exchanged the letters signed by Sultan of Brunei and Prime Minister of Malaysia on the delimitation of the maritime boundary between the two countries in this area. But unfortunately, the content of this agreement is not open for the public. So you can ask the question to my colleagues from Malaysia, Mr. Husin, about that. So next area, we have the boundary of the continental trend between the Malaysia and Indonesia in 1969. But between the two countries, still existing overlapping areas for the EEZ. And it's the case the two countries have separated the line of delimitation. So it's still in the process of negotiation. Between Vietnam and Indonesia has one overlapping continental strand areas of about 40,000 kilometers. The first round of negotiation between Republic of Vietnam and Indonesia in 1973, but there was no result. And then from 1978 to 2003, you can imagine it's a very long period of the consultation, the two countries reached agreement on the delimitation of the continental chain between the two countries. But there is still the problem of the EEZ overlapping areas between the two countries. And now we have 6 rounds of negotiation between the two countries in this area. And this month we have the 7 rounds of negotiation. So next, we have the one overlapping areas with Malaysia of about 2,800 square kilometers. The reason why we have these overlapping areas because of the claim of Vietnam based on the equidistant line between the islands of Vietnam and main coast of Malaysia. And Malaysia takes the equidistant line between the coast of Malaysia and coast of Vietnam, ignoring the effects of island of Vietnam. It's not so big area, but it's very rich by oil and gas potentials. And the leaders of the two countries were very smart when they signed the MOU on the joint development of this area. And now we have a lot of the benefits from this area. Between Vietnam, Thailand, and Malaysia have a small, the overlapping areas between the three countries of about 8 hundreds square kilometers. And in 1998, we have agreement to have joint development between the three countries. And in this area, we still have the joint development area between Thailand and Malaysia in 1979. Even they have the maritime boundary here in this area. Between Vietnam and Thailand, we have one overlapping area of about the 6,000 square kilometers. The reason why we have these overlapping areas, the Vietnam in 1971 claimed a line of boundary based on the equidistant line between the coastal islands of Vietnam and the coast of Thailand. At the same time, in 1973, Thailand claimed equidistant line based on the equidistant line between coast of Vietnam and coast of Thailand. And from 1992 to 1997, the two countries conducted many rounds of negotiation and consultation, and as a result, the two countries have agreement on the delimitation by single line for both continental shelf and EEZ. And Vietnam gained about the 30% of this overlapping area. So next, we have the overlapping area between Thailand and Cambodia. The area is about 22,000 square kilometers. And I don't know whether they have the negotiation or consultation about that or not. And the last one, we have the overlapping area with Cambodia. Before July 1982, between the two countries, still existing the dispute over the sovereignty over the islands in this area. But in July 1982, the two countries signed agreement on the historic joint internal water in this area. And the both sides agreed to use a line called Brevi Line for dividing sovereignty of the island in this area. It means that the Phu Quoc and Tho Chu Island belong to Vietnam, and Uruguay and Pirates Island belong to Cambodia. And you may ask me, what is this Brevi Line? When is it adopted? And why? It's before 1939, between the authority, the French authority in Cambodia and French authority in southern part of Vietnam, have dispute over the right of collecting taxes and fishing in this area. Then the governor, French governor in Indochina, Brevia, decided to use one line from the land boundary between the two countries, go to the sea in this area, and he said that from now, the authority of Cambodia have the right for connecting the taxes and fishing on the northern part of this line. And the Vietnamese authority have the right for collecting the taxes in southern part of this line. So, and he says that this line is purely administrative line. It's not the line for dividing sovereignty of the island in this area. So because he has no power, no authority for the sovereignty issues. So the two governments of Vietnam and Cambodia agreed to use this line just for dividing the sovereignty of this island in this area. But the boundary is not yet agreed.
Okay. I'm sorry, and we're going to wrap it up.
Okay, so I have one minute only. So, and in conclusion, I would like to say that the is a South China Sea still existing overlapping areas, but the claims must be based on the principle of the land dominates the sea and must be mutually accepted by the other states. And the most of the claims of the state in the South China Sea based on the equidistant line or median line between the two countries, with accounting the effect of the island or without accounting the effect of the island. And the agreements of the delimitation between the coastal state mostly based on the equidistant line, and they use the single line for both EZ and continental shelf delimitation, except the cases between Indonesia and other countries in the South China Sea. And the pending delimitation of the overlapping areas, some agreements of soil development have been also reached in this area, formed by the legally reasonable claims and really overlapped or in dispute. And I think that the agreement of the South China Sea are good international practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For
well, now we'll move to the question and answer period. And let me just first, we've had four excellent presentations. The first by Ms. Gupta, describing how the status quo is changing through land reclamation. The second by Dr. Duchatel, indicating how China's desire to turn the South China Sea into a maritime bastion for its submarines may be affecting or driving this the situation. Dr. Kraft went through the confrontation between China and smaller claimant countries and concluded by pointing out that today, with the involvement of the US, with doing freedom of navigation patrols, the conflict is entering a slightly more complicated stage now, with the US more directly involved. And finally, Mr. Quynh, Dr. Quynh, indicating that this region actually has a history of peaceful and lawful delimitation of contested boundaries. So with that, we'll begin. We'll follow the same procedure as in the first session. We'll give priority to the participants at the first table, and we'll start with Dr. Thayer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have two questions, one to Rukmani Gupta and the other to Dr. Duchatel. In your presentation, I think you used the word land reclamation repeatedly. Why use the word land reclamation? You know, it's not land that's been eroded by natural waves and wind. In China's case, it's dredging the ocean floor and it's gouging coral reefs. The litmus test of looking at all these construction activities isn't necessarily China's size and scope, well, that's important, but to me, it's the November 2002 Declaration on Conduct of Parties. What activities complicate or escalate disputes and affect peace and stability? So is Vietnam taking barges of land and dropping it off a threat or not? Next, if you look at the Office of National Intelligence that shows you the airstrips, China's is three times larger than Vietnam's, and it dwarfs all the other, and it's not just one, it's several. And I think that point has to be made, because that gets to my second question to Dr. Duchatel. You mentioned the use of helicopters on Fiery Cross Reef with anti-submarine warfare capabilities. Two questions arise from me. How does that affect Vietnam's enhanced Kilo submarine base at Cam Ranh Bay, just opposite? So the kind of counter to that particular threat. And two, since 1995, when Southeast Asia adopted the Southeast Asia Nuclear Weapons Free Zone Treaty, China has repeatedly wanted to sign the protocol, but ASEAN's put that off, wanting the other nuclear powers to join. How, with the deployment of Jin-class ballistic missile submarines, can we square Southeast Asia's desire for a nuclear weapons free zone treaty with these activities? Thank you.
Okay. We'll take another question. Professor Jimbo.
Well, thank you very much. I also like to raise a question to Dr. Duchatel, and which is a follow-up question on the previous speaker. You mentioned about the emphasis and importance of the Chinese PLA Navy's vulnerability in the nuclear deterrence strategy, and obviously that South China Sea will provide PLN greater strategic depth in terms of their maneuverability on the submarine forces. But still, there are a lot of points that I think you need to elaborate because, first of all, that the missile range of the Jingcrest JL-2 can only access 8,000 kilometers, which only covers Hawaii or parts of Alaska. And what would be the meaning of the positioning of the strategic submarines in the South China Sea, and what would ensure the credible second strike capability in that technological requirements? And you also mentioned about the reference to the Soviet Union's submarine fleet's Okhotsk strategy in reference to the importance of the South China Sea. But Okhotsk obviously was surrounded by its Soviet, almost like a perfect strategic superiority vis-a-vis the neighboring states. But South China Sea is surrounded by many neighbors, and especially by Philippines. And then there will be a potential additional augmentation assets, especially in the Palawan, which United States and Philippines jointly can provide the anti-submarine warfare assets in the future. In with regard to those dynamics, how much you can really ensure that Chinese PLA navies and second artillery forces can actually see the South China Sea as a most credible base for the second strike capability?
Okay. Thank you. We'll take one more this round. Is that Professor Gao?
Thank you. I would just make a very brief comment. As a lawyer, I would urge that people be very careful in choosing the term of militarization to describe the situation on the ground. Well, I just raised an example, like what happened in the first hearing of the South China Sea arbitration. When facing the questions posed by the tribunal, the Philippine legal team said to the tribunal that the Philippines does not argue that the land reclamation in Mischief Reef constitute military activities. And the award on jurisdiction made by the tribunal most recently is very careful and for the moment refrains from declaring that there is any military activities carried out by the Chinese government in the Mischief Reef or said land reclamations. And secondly, I think militarization with defensive nature by UN member states is not affected nor negated by UN Charter, for example, Article 51. Because we have to understand that the land reclamation is not equal to militarization with offensive nature, because South China Sea bordering states are suffering from a common frustration that most of the territories they claim are occupied by foreign states. On the one hand, they cannot afford the further losing of island territories. On the other hand, they cannot abandon the national aspirations to recover the lost territories. It is in this context that the land reclamation activities by all these states must be understood and sympathized by outsiders. The last point, such land reclamation activities with defensive nature by all the South China Sea bordering states is thus not stopped by the request by Ashton Carter, who is the defensive secretary of the US, who in the Shangri-La dialogue recently urged all these states to stop immediately the land reclamation activities. Deep inside the minds of these states, I guess, the underlying principle used by the US to settle the South China Sea territorial disputes, namely the uti possidetis principle, cannot be accepted by all of them. Therefore, my characterization of the situation on the ground is a common militarization with defensive nature, but not offensive nature. Thank you.
Great, okay. Would you like to respond?
I'll respond to Professor Thayer's comment about why is it called land reclamation. Well, you're absolutely right. I'm using the term that is frequently in used in common parlance, but it is in fact, as I mentioned also in my presentation, the creation of new artificial terrain, and that is what I refer to it as. As far as the declaration of the code of conduct, the 2002 declaration is concerned, again, you're absolutely right that there is a violation of, where there is a perception that there is a violation of what China agreed to do or not to do within this code, but my contention is that it is not international law or these codes that are in fact determining the activities of states within the Spratlys or determining building activities within these islands. Building activity has now become a function of capability rather than essentially international law permission or even territorial claims. So whereas 10 years ago, perhaps China did not have the wherewithal to invest in the creation of artificial terrain, it does so right now. And this is a rhetoric that is often found in Chinese discussion, or Chinese scholars often say that as China changes, as its capabilities changes, what it does on the ground will also change. And if we go by that logic, clearly as capabilities improve or increase, we can expect there to be greater activity on the ground. Oh, just a second, you also mentioned about the length of airstrip. So you're absolutely right. The airstrip that Vietnam fields is 550 meters. Taiping Island has an airstrip of about 1,200, whereas the one at Fiery Cross is, of course, 3,125 meters. So there is a significant gap in the airstrips that each of these countries now fields.
Thank you for your questions. First, regarding Professor Tyer's question, with respect to the nuclear weapons free zone in Southeast Asia, I think that's precisely the type of agreements that should be used in a negotiation with China regarding the South China Sea. And if I was a diplomat in the Southeast Asian state, I would use the treaty to address the question of militarization of the South China Sea by China, and the question of nuclear submarines operations. I think it's a very good entry point. So on the one hand, you have this entry point, and on the other hand, you have the US-China nuclear security dialogue. And these two channels could be used to address the question that I'm discussing in the paper. Then there's a number of questions regarding the South China Sea, the feasibility of a Soviet-type bastion in the South China Sea, and doubts have been rightly risen by two participants. I think it's relative. You need to compare the South China Sea with the East China Sea and the Bohai Sea. And if you do that, you will realize that the South China Sea has a number of features that makes it a potentially easier area to protect nuclear submarines than the East China Sea and the Bohai Sea for two different reasons. To be quick on that, it really deserves a long discussion, but the East China Sea has Japan in front of China, and everyone knows that the Japanese anti-submarine warfare capacities are among the best in the world and the most numerous, so it's difficult to operate in that area. And the Bohai Sea is just too shallow if you compare with the South China Sea. Now, if you look at the South China Sea, it's true that many neighbors have anti-submarine warfare capacities, including Vietnam, including the kilos that were mentioned by Professor Thayer, and that it's going to be extremely challenging for China. I'm not saying that it's an easy strategy. I'm saying that it's easier than attempting to cross the first island chain undetected. In terms of what kind of capacities China needs to counter if it wants to achieve a bastion in the South China Sea, well, here again, it's a very complicated matter. But I think you can at least make a distinction between surveillance that is conducted from the air and surveillance that is conducted from nuclear attack submarines. And on the first part, I think that China is making very rapid progress in deploying and acquiring the capacities to prevent surveillance conducted from the air with a number of assets. When it comes to surveillance conducted by a variety of submarines, this is really a weakness of China. And final points regarding the GL2 and the fact that its range is only 8,000 kilometers. Yes, of course, if China has to rely on the GL2, and it's been tested, but there is doubt regarding the operational status of the missile. If China has to rely on the GL2, it will have to cross the first island chain. But I think that the plan is the GL3. it's part of the strategic thinking. It's a step by step process.
On the question of militarization, does anybody want to?
I think the point is well taken that one should be careful when using the term militarization, and certainly the construction of defensive structures is within every state's right. So if you look at how Taiwan has declared that it is going to use the new harbor to basically field its new 3,000-ton Coast Guard cutters on Taiping Tao, and that it is going to utilize the airstrip and deploy C-130 transports essentially for humanitarian purposes. But when you compare that with what China has also characterized as essentially the creation of structures for civilian purposes and for scientific purposes, scientific exploration that would include all of what its construction activities in the Spratlys, I think there is a difference in the threat perception that each of these construction activities for defensive purposes actually leads to. So if you look at the National Development and Reform Commission under the State Council on 14th June this year, actually issued a directive outlining exactly what sorts of structures would be constructed by China in the Spratlys. And these were essentially lighthouses, comprehensive communication facilities, but also waste disposal and sewage plant, treatment plants, as well as desalination plants. So while according to China, all of this falls within a defensive or a purely civilian utilization of new structures. For other countries, it may well signal long-term intent of creating manned military outposts in the Spratlys. So infrastructure can be used either way. So how you use that 3,000-meter runway is what remains to be seen.
Thank you. Okay, we'll go on to some other questions. Mr. Hayton.
Hello. A question for Ms. Gupta and a question for Dr. Quynh. Ms. Gupta, I wondered if you'd be able to produce a timeline. Who dredged the first dredge? And is it possible to say that one claimant's actions were a precedent set or precedent setting for another one to claim they were only doing what someone else was doing? And for Dr. Quynh, I understand when President Xi was here that Vietnam and China agreed further talks on delimitation of the mouth of the Gulf of Tonkin. How will these be any different to the previous rounds? And could you tell us a bit more about the talks? I mean, it should be a simple matter to delimit from a point that's already been negotiated at the mouth up to a point some distance from the Paracel Islands, which, when it becomes in dispute, that section should be very easy to delimit. Why does China refuse to delimit that section? What does it tell you in the talks?
Professor Odegaard.
Thank you. I have two questions, one for Kraft and one for Duchatel. For Kraft, you mentioned the code of conduct, declaration of conduct issue, and I would like you to speak a bit more about that. I think it's often mentioned as the way forward, but to me, that thinking came out of the early 2000s, late 90s, where the strategic environment was considerably different and China's engagement with the region was very different. So to me, I think it's, I'm just a bit skeptical, frankly, about the feasibility or, how much would a code help. So I wonder if you could comment a bit on that. And for Duchatel, thank you for a very interesting presentation. I just wanted you to, if you could expand on the kind of military strategic thinking lying behind this, because you make references to the Cold War and the Soviet Union. So how much of this strategic thinking is in China is inspired by the Cold War concept? How much is inspired by newer Chinese strategic thinking? And have they adjusted to developments in the US military, or, you know, can you expand on that? Thank you.
Right, and yes, would you like to ask a question?
Thank you.
No, the lady right there.
Thank
right
you.
Before you.
I have a question for Dr. Li Quynh. And you provide a very comprehensive picture on the maritime delimitation status in the South China Sea. So the two cases that you explained to us, one is that Gulf Tonkin delimitation, and the other is between Vietnam and Malaysia. I have an impression that Vietnam tends to recognize the effect of insular features in maritime delimitation. In the future delimitation in Spotless, it's quite clear, three steps, the sovereignty issues, and then the entitlement of those insular features, and then the effect of features in maritime delimitation. I would like you to share your view, or Vietnam's view, on what kind of effect, or whether it's the possibility for the insular features to play some certain effect in maritime delimitation in near the areas in Spratly, and if you happen to know the views and position from other claimant states, and I would like you to share with that. Thank you.
Yes, I guess we'll take you. Yeah.
Thank you. I'd just like to have a short question to Mr. Rukmani Gupta. You mentioned about the 7 out of 10 being carried out reclamation work in the South, in the South China Sea, but I know what is happening at Quatron Reef. You miss out the Quatron Reef just now. So if you have any pictures or satellite images of Quatron Reef, thank you.
Okay. So who dredged first?
So I have no idea who dredged first, but I think the justification that if one party is dredging and the other party dredges, that's justified, possibly under international law or any sort of law. If one party is doing something wrong and the other one does something wrong, that wouldn't be justified. So I'll leave it to the lawyers to discuss why or dredging may or may not be the correct way forward for any of the claimants. But given that the creation of defensive structures has had a long history within these islands, within the Paracels as well as the Spratlys, Chinese scholars do use the justification that this is a long-standing tradition and they're not exactly breaking any rules, or they're not the exception to any particular rule when they face criticism regarding their own activities here. So it was only in that vein that I mentioned this. No, I don't have any images of Quatron and Lady Reef on immediately, but I'd be happy to share with you analysis on this perhaps outside of the conference. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the questions concerning the delimitation. As I mentioned in my presentation, the Isle of Tonkin, the starting point or starting position of China is based on the equidistant line between the coast of Vietnam and coast of China. And then we have some adjustment taking into account the effect of the island there. But at the mouth of Tonkin between Vietnam and China, we have clear position based on the equidistant line between the baseline of the two countries. But China never say that what is their position is the first. You are right when you mentioned about the Paracel Island. Still in the dispute between China and Vietnam. China claims sovereignty over this island fully, and Vietnam also claim our sovereignty over this island fully. So if we take the effect of this island in these overlapping areas, it's very complicated. So we have to limit the area of overlapping between the two countries in this area without any effects of the Paracen Island. And concerning the question about the joint submission between China, Vietnam and Malaysia, southern part of the Spratly Islands. In this submission, we imply that the small islands and features of the two archipelagos, Paracen and Spratlys, are not suitable for the habitation of for human beings in these areas. So we think that these features have no EEZ and continental strand. So it has no impact on the delimitation in the South China Sea. It's our position. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. How much is it inspired by the how much is China's strategic thinking today regarding this inspired by China's analysis of the Cold War? I think it's really not decisive. I would argue that this is not decisive and that there are other factors that affect China's strategic thinking on that issue much more than the study of the Cold War and the US-Soviet game, military game and submarine game during that period. First, I think it comes directly from China's own experience of facing the US during the Cold War. And then I think that if there is an influence of the Soviet Union or Russia, it is more diffused through the transfer of naval power from Russia today to China than the experience of the Cold War directly. When you think of it, many Chinese submarines are Russian or have benefited from Russian transfers of technology. And I think it's particularly important in the case of the aircraft carrier, because the aircraft carrier that was purchased from Russia was built precisely to support that kind of operations, mobile air defense. And finally, and I think that this is the decisive factor regarding the issue we are discussing, I think that China and Russia at the moment share a concern regarding the fact that their nuclear deterrence strategy is being challenged by the US missile defense system, and that this is really at the core of their threat perception. And it applies obviously to a number of political issues, for example, on the Korean Peninsula with the deployment of radar equipment that is threatening both Russia and China. And I would argue that what is happening in the South China Sea with surveillance and counter surveillance is the equivalent at sea of what is going on with the construction of the missile defense program by the US. And on this, there's clearly sharing between China and Russia in terms of threat perceptions and how to face this threat.
Thanks, Dr. Odegaard, on this one. Regarding the code of conduct, I share your skepticism on whether or not it's the right document to actually emphasize now. If I remember correctly, some of the discussions that actually came out of it and the continuing ones that are there might be attributed more to the, well, at the time when it was actually starting, we didn't have the cues, the code on the on unintended events. And so something similar was actually being discussed, and it was somehow being, shall we say, overlaid, with the idea of a of the code of conduct. But you're right on two things. One is the idea that this was actually the discussions on this actually started at a time when relations were very different, and therefore a code of conduct actually made much more sense. With tensions as they are now, I think you're really talking about something else in terms of the objective of trying to prevent any escalation in the situation. And something similar to the cues is actually a much better prospect, I think. But as many have actually talked about it, the code and unintended events actually lack the involvement of white ships or white hulls, for instance, right? It only covers naval vessels. And something similar should actually be established, not to cover the activities of Coast Guard vessels as well. And I think the other thing about the Code of Conduct is that this is an ASEAN initiative. And as far as ASEAN is actually concerned, this has been the main platform within which they've been discussing, you know, how states involved in the South China Sea dispute should actually be, or at least their behavior should actually be regulated, and that's been a continuing one. I'm almost tempted to say that there's just some sort of inertia as far as thinking about new ideas, but really the tendency has been to equate the code of conduct with something similar to the cues.
Professor Su.
Okay, thank you, Chairman. I have a question, actually three questions to some panelists. And question one goes to our Indian presenters, Ms. Gupta. So in your presentation, you talked quite a lot about the reclamation behaviors over the South China Sea conducted by all the claimants around the South China Sea, right? So you mentioned that not only China, but some other claimants also do the same way. So thanks for your informative sort of picture on the screen, right? So, and also you said that by this way, the status quo already changed, right? So my question to you that, so since then, after that, and if we had take the reasonable way to manage the issues over the South China Sea, so we should need the common foundation for the management. Maybe we need a definition of a new status quo. So I'm wondering, do you have any ideas or assessment about the how to make us to get the new status quo? Okay, so my second question to our Professor Kraft. Again, I appreciate you give us a good picture. Right, like Xi Jinping, your president show up and the APEC. We got the consensus, actually, is on this multilateral platform for the regional cooperation. Actually, not only is the, just too much focus on the South China Sea. So we know that at our bilateral relations, we have some commitment between our leaders, also our foreign ministers regarding their management or maintain the the stability in the South China Sea. But it seems to me that now Filipino's government prefers or take the preference of the legal way to manage the issues. But we know that we have the two ways, legal and political way, right? So my question to you is that how for the Filipino government to keep the balance between their legal and the political approaches to manage the issues? And my last question to our Vietnamese friends, Professor Quynh. Again, you also give us very good conversion study about the Vietnamese behaviors over the resolution of their maritime differences with your neighbors, including China, Cambodia, Thailand, right? So it's good experiences for us in the past. That means there's some kind of successful way to resolve our problem or even to manage our differences. So my question to you that, as you mentioned that Vietnamese is, I think Vietnamese is so smart than China to manage their sort of Tonkin Bay area, the demarcation over there, their maritime area. So my question to you is, from your point of view, how for the Vietnamese to get the lessons past in the past time to manage these kind of issues successfully, and then to conduct the bilateral dialogue with China? As we know that we have several working groups over the South China Sea. So how to apply these successful lessons to promote the negotiation between us? Thank you.
Great, and now we can afford to go beyond the first island chain into the second island chain, If there are any questions, we'll go this way. Okay. So, Patrick Cronin? Cameron? Yeah, Cameron, sorry.
Thank you. Cameron Mitchell, Hong Kong Shanghai Bank. I had a question for Dr. Duchatel. I think when you roll in the nuclear deterrent aspect to Chinese thinking in the South China Sea, it really opens up an entirely new dynamic to the way the issue should be handled or should be considered. I wanted to ask you a little bit more about your briefing. I agree with you 100%. The JL2 probably is a transitional system. You know, you build a strategy for your submarines beyond the technology you have today. So therefore, if there is a longer range system coming online, the Bastion strategy you discuss works well. And obviously, China doesn't have a great deal of options in terms of the water it can actually operate the submarine. So maybe not as good as Sea of Okhotsk, but as good as China can expect. With that in mind, there's obviously also the development of their land-based deterrent, the DF-31 series. The first question is, would China be comfortable with minimal deterrence with the DF-31 series only? If they would be, then that puts a different light on the South China Sea. If they're not, and if China expects the JL-2 and or whatever it may be, JL-3 series to be vital to its minimal nuclear deterrence, well then, quite frankly, that means that any discussion we have here about settling the South China Sea dispute will probably go out the window, I think. So if I could get your comment on that. Thank you.
Okay, others? Yeah, there's one here. Yes, can you identify yourself?
Thank you, Chairman. My name is Quynh Wong from National Taiwan Normal University in Taipei. Two comments to Ms. Gupta for your excellent presentation. I especially enjoy those wonderful images and very fascinating and very informative. However, having said that, I would like to say something about the construction on Taiping Island. Because I got the opportunity and I'm really lucky to visit there for a couple times for the past 3 years. And then I can offer in certain information about the construction. Basically, most of the port facilities construction is built up on an old wharf, which was built in 1978, just to strengthen the old infrastructure so that the transshipment either for the personnel or for the goods, that will be easier and safer. And then why we need to transship the personnel and goods? Basically, that is for the services in one hospital on that island. That hospital got a very advanced facilities to offer the emergent medical treatments to the personnel on land or to those fishermen in the neighborhood. And so far as I can remember, for the past 10 years, the hospital had already offered more than 10 times of treatments to the fishermen in the surrounding countries, including Philippines, Vietnam, and Brunei. So, and also, I would like to also have a discussion about the status quo that Ms. Gupta also mentioned. I think that specific term should also be careful in use. So for example, what's the definition about status quo? For example, like the personnel stationed in Taiping Island, my government had already switched the personnel from the original Navy and the Mariner to the Coast Guard, which in the nature of law enforcement in the year 2000, would that be also would that also be an changing of the status quo? So basically, I would like to say that when we use the term of the changing the status quo, we have to be careful about its positive way and also not only on the negative way. Thank you.
Thank you. So the first question was how to manage.
Well, let me just begin by explaining how I use the term status quo, which I explained on my last slide. And essentially, my use of the term status quo, or the change in status quo, was used to denote a change in the curtailment of activities that claimants, various claimants, had been able to undertake. So yes, there was a negative connotation that I implied to the term status quo. Now, coming to Professor Suhao's question on how do you create a new status quo on the South China Sea. First of all, well, I guess implicit in this question is the belief that what exists on the ground will remain on the ground. So the first part would be accepting that what has been built will not be unbuilt or demolished. But from what would be required of China would be to move away from this rhetoric on indisputable sovereignty and a recognition that there is in fact a dispute and that there is the creation of threat or there is a threat perception amongst its neighbors that emanates from not only the wide gulf in naval or non-naval capabilities, but also as far as there is very little clarity on what China seeks to do. So my idea for establishing a new status quo would be the creation of maybe confidence building measures, where you say on these new features, this is the kind of tonnage that we would have, or this is the kind of missile system that these platforms could possibly use. But I am not sure if China would be willing to accept this sort of movement towards this sort of agreement, because again, by its very definition, it would be curtailing Chinese sovereignty to operate in what it considers an inalienable part of China. So I think the first order of business would be to move away from this emphasis on indisputable sovereignty.
Next, the legal the strategy of the Philippines be dealing with China.
Thank you for the question. I think the question had to do with how does the Philippines balance between the legal and or a legal and a political strategy. That's easy. It doesn't. At this point, all the eggs are actually in the legal basket. At this point. There's a minimal use of the political side of things as far as the Philippines is actually concerned. And if there is, or there are political initiatives being pushed, it's being done at a very low technical level more than anything else. So at the political level, it's really more of the legal strategy that's actually being utilized at this point in time.
Okay, and the Philippines, how are you going to try to delimit in the future based on past experience?
Oh, thank you very much for the questions. And actually, we have some successful cases on the delimitation between our country with the neighboring countries. And of course, we are not smarter than the other people to get success in the delimitation. All the parties must be smart, is the first what I would say. The second one, I would like to say that in order to reach the final agreement, the starting point for the negotiation is a reasonable claim and mutually accepted as a starting point for the negotiation. And in the most cases in the South China Sea, the claim of the coastal states are based on the equidistant line with accounting the effects of the island or without accounting of the island. And then we can accept it, this line, for the starting point for negotiation with some adjustment in order to reach the final solution. The third point I would like to say here, before the negotiation started, we should have agreement on the principle of negotiation. What is a principle? Is a principle on the equity, the limitation, based on the international law with a reference to the international practice. And the last point, of course, we should have the goodwill of the concerned parties. Without the goodwill of the parties, we cannot reach agreement. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your question. I'm not going to give you a very firm answer. I think that even people in the arms industry in the US or in China working on the DF-31A or working in anti-missile defense do not have the full picture of the balance of power between the two. But I can say a few things, to help clarify the question. The first thing I would say is that it's a pity that there are not more Chinese publications on nuclear doctrine, because the best we have so far, to my knowledge, is the publication by the MIT professor Tyler Frevel, and it's called Assured Retaliation. So that's what we know about the Chinese nuclear doctrine, starting from the development of nuclear weapons by China, that the goal was only to have one that would be enough to target an opponent. If you take this as the starting point to think of the two choices, one being undersea deterrence and the other one being using ballistic missiles, I think that it's safe to say that China will pursue the two at the same time, especially given the fact that the offense-defense balance between ballistic missiles and missile defense and between surveillance and counter-surveillance at sea is constantly changing and will continue to do so. So I don't see China making the decision at some point that give up the nuclear, the submarine part of its deterrence strategy to focus only on the on ballistic missiles.
Thank you. Well, I think we're at the end of our session time. It's about 3 o'clock. I think we could all use some coffee right now. And let's thank the panelists for their presentations.